Well, good morning. Good to see everybody.
Good morning.
Yeah. Good morning. It's good to be here today. Sorry to interrupt your conversations, but we're online now. So, welcome. We're here to worship God and bring ourselves as an offering. And that's the thing He desires more than anything else you might have, is just your heart, your mind, giving yourself fully to this moment. A couple of things that I want to highlight. It's been kind of a tough 2 or 3 days here for us in our fellowship, directly and indirectly. Mr. Ken Hollis, some of y'all will remember him, older gentleman, joined I think the first Sunday in December. He'd been coming here a little bit longer than that, but had some surgery, was out for a while, but joined with the fellowship, retired from ministry, and he passed away. Heard from his daughter, and so being in prayer for that family. And then this afternoon at 2 o'clock, there'll be a funeral down in Unadilla. Mr. Jackie Bowen's mom passed away, and Gail and I were spending some time over there with them Friday evening after we found out about that. And I love it's such a beautiful thing when a follower of Christ lets their faith shape how they handle the death of a loved one. It really is. It's a beautiful thing. And, of course, his mama was a believer, so she's home. And then one of the unique members of this church, Mr. Wayne Mullis, he stepped into eternity. And I was sitting in the office earlier today thinking about there's almost a game that Mr. Wayne, Miss Betty, and Gail and I would play in the local restaurants on Sunday. It was who could buy the other one's lunch. And it got so ridiculous that the last time Mr. Wayne got me, he saw us when they came in the door. He stopped right then before he was even seated and said, "I'm paying for theirs." And that's how it got back and forth. And we would catch them. We'd see them come in and sneak up there and pay for theirs. And he would just, I'd get away with him. I should be doing that for you. I said, "No, sir. Mr. Wayne is home." And his funeral will be Wednesday. We don't have a time, at least that I know of, but we do know it will be on Wednesday. So those things going on. A couple of scheduling things, just by way of reminder, Legacy Builders Retreat down to Epworth by the Sea on St. Simon's. Sign up 2 more days. The 31st is the last day. Sign up, $50 registration fee, and then the balance is due later. I can't recall that date, but they'll let you know in the office. Come by, and then our Disciple Now, if you have a child or a grandchild, a student that would be involved in that, grade 7 through 12, they're conducting sign up. You can call the church office. There's a QR code in the newsletter, and probably it's flashed up there. There it is right there that you can use to sign up with your phone, and that would be a great thing. All right. It's good to be together to worship, isn't it?
Amen.
Yeah. And so I think we ought to sing our opening prayer. Maybe worthy of worship. Can we?
I think we can manage.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
We have come into this place because God is worthy of everything. Most of all, this morning in this hour, He is worthy of our worship. Would you stand together as we sing, "Worthy of Worship"?
Worthy of all the glass of sweetness, sing, worthy.
PK taught us that we always should begin our praise with an acknowledgement of who he is. So would you join me in singing that chorus one more time? You are worthy, this time without the instruments, just lifting our voices. You are worthy. We continue our worship as we praise him for all that he is. We sing together, praise him, praise him. Somebody that is joining our church staff for the next bit of while he's finishing up his theological training. Ben, would you come and lead us in prayer this morning?
Absolutely. So of course, Keith asked me to do this in our Wednesday meeting, and so I was thinking through, okay, well, what would match up with the songs that we're singing and the sermon? And I came up with a great verse, but then, of course, I found out on Saturday that Uncle Wayne had passed, and to quote the great Mike Tyson, everybody has a plan until you get hit in the face. So I began scouring the scriptures, looking for something, some words to hold on to in this time of grief, and words that I could share with this church family that meant so much to Uncle Wayne. And the Lord led me to John 11, verses 25 and 26. This is Jesus comforting Martha and Mary after they lost their brother. And it says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? And I can confidently answer that question. I believe that. And I know Uncle Wayne believed that. So yes, we will say goodbye on Wednesday, but we will also say, see you later. And I'm very encouraged by that, and I hope you are as well. And now let's go to the Lord and say thank you for that incredible gift that he's given us. Oh, Lord God, you are so good. You're so good to us. God, and of course, we come humbly before your throne and just to say thank you. Thank you for this gift of eternal life that you've given us and this time that we've gotten to spend with family and friends. God, and we ask for your blessing on this church, God, in the service, as we continue to praise your holy name. God, we ask all of these things in your son's amazing and holy name.
Throughout this Epiphany season, one of the things that we will be looking at, is the disciplines of the Christian life. We've already looked at prayer. We have already looked at beginning to look at Bible study. We'll continue that. And I think I heard from PK that starting tomorrow, we'll be fasting all the way through the end of February. No eating at all whatsoever to deal with all that December eating that we did. I don't think so. I doubt that I would participate in that. You can see, but we are looking at what God's word means to us and what it can mean for us as we dig deeper in. So, would you continue our worship as we sing together, "Word of God across the ages, and God has spoken by His prophets."
Thank you.
children in Sunday school or vacation Bible school, would you stand together as we sing Holy Bible, Book Divine?
Oh,
Okay, while the choir's going out, I need some help. Need a couple of guys down here on the floor to give out some stuff. I need a runner to the balcony.
I'm still young.
Okay. You run, Ben. So, you know, we started last week looking at the importance of personal Bible study time, right on the heels of talking about really developing this intentional habit of conversation with God, just entering into His presence with a heart that just wants to spend time with Him. Both are equally important. And I don't want to jump in. This is the continued outline. You'll see it's front and back this week. We covered five perks of Bible study last week. We're going to look at four more and then next Sunday do something kind of unique, maybe a little unique. I'm going to give time. As these guys continue to give out stuff, let me ask you, Ben shared about his uncle and beautiful words. Pray for Ben. Ben's going to be preaching Wayne's funeral on Wednesday, and that'll be a challenge. Preparation-wise, but also emotionally. That's never an easy thing to do. So y'all say a word of prayer for Ben. I'm sure he would appreciate that. I hope I ran off enough. If not, we might have to ask some couples to share one. Doing good. Those of you watching online, hang in there with us. We're done here in just a second. Ben, are you going to have enough, you think?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes, sir. Thank you. All right, we're good. Everybody get one that wants one. If you want one but didn't get one, raise your hand. They're free. Absolutely free. Okay, so I don't know if you're a note taker or not. I think taking notes is great. It's a great way of learning and remembering. And I don't do this a lot, but I think it's a really good thing. I want you to turn on the back of that, and you'll see some empty lines down there, things worth remembering. And before we actually look at perk number six, I want to make sure, I should have done this last week, but didn't. So I want you to write this down. It's going to be on the screen. The end game of personal Bible study is intimately knowing God. That's the end game. That's what it's all about. God has revealed Himself to us in Scripture. So the more we are drenched in Scripture, the deeper our relationship, the intimacy of our relationship with God. So the end game of personal Bible study, why it's so important, is intimately knowing God, as opposed to or rather than simply acquiring info about God. There's a big difference there. And sometimes I've worked with people who kind of approach Bible study like they're studying for a Bible trivia game, just seeking bits and pieces of information to store away in case they ever need to answer. Bible study is way more than just acquiring info about God. It is knowing God. That's how we come to know Him in a deeper way. So we approach it with that sense. You could learn a lot of facts or a lot of information about something but have no personal knowledge of it. Am I right? Like, for instance, for me personally, I could study every fact that there is, every detail out there related to the origins and the design and the construction of the Eiffel Tower. I could even tell you that from the pictures I've seen, it's really beautiful. I could maybe even tell you that it's really beautiful at night when it's all lit up. But all of that would be secondhand because I do not have personal knowledge of the Eiffel Tower. I've never been there. I've never stood at the ground and looked up and really sensed the scope and the size of that thing and never beheld its beauty up close. Now, I guarantee you, someone who has been there, some of you probably have, It's overwhelming, I would guess. Sometimes we learn things about God, but the goal of Bible study is not to just learn stuff, information about Him, but it's to know him personally, to bring that truth into your life and allow the Holy Spirit to use it to shape your heart. So just wanted you to hold on to that. So when we talk about perks of Bible study, these are things that just accrue into your life as a result of your pursuit of relationship with God, fellowship with God, intimacy with God through Bible study. They just, if you're studying your Bible regularly, these things are going to start showing up in your life, okay? And we looked at five last week, and we're going to look at four more today, and then we'll be done. Perk number six. Now, we're back on the bottom of the front page. You'll see it down there, okay? It's the statement that has the little blanks in it. That means you have to pay attention to be able to fill those in. Yeah, right back in school here, aren't we? Okay? Perk number six, personal Bible study prepares me to converse with unbelievers about Christ. It's incredible. The more you dig into the Word, soak your heart in the Word, hide the Word of God in your heart, it prepares you for those conversations that hopefully you're having with unbelievers. Okay? As a pastor for 40 years, I don't know how many times people have said to me, the reason I don't share my faith is because I don't know my Bible very well, or I don't know where the verses are. Or I don't know, and I say, you know what? You can remedy that. You can remedy that personal Bible study. A great personal Bible study, for instance, if that's you and that's somewhere you feel a little weak, do a personal Bible study of all the verses, especially in the New Testament, that have to do with salvation. I mean, study them. Get them into your heart. Wrestle with the meanings of those things. You know, do a study, a personal study on the Roman road. How many of you remember the Roman road? Who's ever walked down the Roman road? Man, I tell you what, that thing was taught in our churches in the 60s, 70s, 80s, pamphlets, flyers, witnessing tracts. It's beautiful. You know, starting all the way in Romans chapter 1, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of salvation. And going on to Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. What does that mean? And wrestle with that. But studying the Bible. In 1 Peter chapter 3, beginning at verse 15 down through 16, this is what the Bible says. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. Always be ready to speak to your faith, to have conversations about your faith, to give a defense of your faith, whatever it is. So there's one of the perk number six, right there. Perk number seven, moving right through here. And I'm going to say that these last three, especially the last two, are closely related, but they're really important. Perk number seven, personal Bible study simplifies the process of choosing between right and wrong. It makes it a very simple thing. The more you know about the Bible, the deeper you get into the Word, the more you study it, the more you listen to the voice of God by way of His Holy Spirit in you, the more you clearly see what the Bible defines as right and wrong, righteous and unrighteous, good and evil. And that simplifies the decision-making process. As followers of Christ, when we look at something, when we're making a choice, when a temptation comes our way, whatever it is, we look at it and say, what does God say about that? And if God says that's evil, that's unrighteous, that's wrong, that makes the choice really simple, right? I'm not going to do that. I can't do that. I won't go that way. I'm not going to participate in that. Why? Because that's what honors God in His Word. It makes it so simple. One of the interesting things about human nature, okay, if we're honest, is when we're considering doing something that we suspect might not be the right thing or the best thing to do, we will go and start asking people's opinions. And what we're doing there is we're looking for people who have the opinion that agrees with our opinion. And so if I ask somebody, hey, I was thinking about them, what are you saying? And that person says, I don't know, you ought to go that way. Okay, thanks. And we go and we ask somebody else. And as soon as we can find two or three who say, you know, go with it, follow your heart, you know, follow your truth, go. They're like, okay, good, I feel better now. That's the most dangerous thing you can do. I would challenge you, when you're facing one of those kind of dilemmas, what's right and wrong, what's good and evil, what's righteous and unrighteous, to go to God's Word, to get in there. God, what do you say about this? And I want to tell you something, now listen to me. There is nothing that you will face in life that the Bible does not address. Directly, indirectly, it's going to be there. When I was when we had moved up to North Carolina to go to seminary, and I had my wife, obviously, and we had one baby at that point. Not long before we had three, but at that point we just had one. Could never figure out where those things came from. And so we went up there. It was kind of a faith journey because we didn't know where we were going to live, what we were going to do. Seminary housing was not available. Married housing at the start of that first semester. And so eventually what happened was Gail and Benjamin went back to Atlanta to live with her mom and dad. And she left me by myself up there. She said, I want being a good husband by not providing shelter. And I said, okay. And she says, as soon as you find some, maybe we'll come back. And so she went there while we were praying through this thing. And so I was looking, going to class and looking, and we had found a duplex, not far off campus, and all this kind of stuff. And we had talked with the owner and looked at what the cost was. And, of course, at this point, I was not working. She was not working. We had a baby. So really, if there was any cost, it was too much. But, what's it cost? And then the owner required that we sign a 12-month lease. And if you, tried to get out of that, there was a penalty built into that 12-month lease. And man, we're, praying about that thing, and, you do that whole thing. If this is God's will he provide for this? Well, yeah, absolutely he can. And back and forth. And it seemed like, because I wanted Gail and my son back. We weren't enjoying that. Gail wasn't enjoying it a whole bunch either. And so it just seemed like the common sense thing to do, But I took my Bible. I was staying with a college friend of mine who was already at seminary. He was gracious, he and his wife, to allow me to stay in their house. I took my Bible and I went out in the woods behind his house and I sat down on a fallen tree. Just started reading. I said, God, I just really need you to speak to me. And so as I just started reading scripture, I came across a verse in Proverbs that said, he who signs an agreement but has no money to pay will be thrown out. It does sound funny, and it was kind of funny, but in that moment, I'm sitting there in the middle of the woods, which happens to be a really beautiful sanctuary, by the way. I love the woods. And I read that verse, and I said, are you kidding me? Seriously? So then I read the context before and after, because I thought, surely not. It's right there. Plain and simple. That's the thing about Proverbs. It's just really straight up wisdom right out there. Boom. So I had a tear come down my face. I thanked my father for his faithfulness. And went and called my wife and said, we can't sign that lease. We can't do that. And so we didn't. Didn't know what was next, but wouldn't you know it, a couple of weeks later, got a call from the school that one of the married housing apartments had just come open, that we still need a place to live. No lease. Cheaper than that stupid duplex I was looking at. And we moved in there, and then 3 months later, I was called to pastor a church in Virginia, and we moved into the parsonage and lived there. God provided. God speaks through his word. God helps us to clearly see the way of righteousness, way of unrighteousness. In Proverbs 16, the Bible talks about all a man's ways are righteous in his own eyes. It's God who directs the steps of man. This whole idea that we need to be careful, because it made such good sense to me to go ahead you know, sign that lease, we'll figure out a way, I'll find a job somewhere. And God said, no, that's not my plan for you. So, perk number 7, it simplifies the whole process of choosing between right and wrong. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:5, 6, and 7, these are two of these are very familiar to us. Verse 7 is one that's, I love the verse. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make straight your paths. But then in verse 7, right after that, he says, be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord. Turn from evil. I think one of the greatest traps we fall into is our trust in ourselves, being wise in our own eyes. Feeling like we, for the most part, can handle most of the stuff just based on our own intelligence. Turn over one chapter in Proverbs chapter 4, verses 5, 6, and 7. Get wisdom. Get insight. Do not forget and do not turn away from the words of my mouth. Do not forsake wisdom and she will keep you. Love wisdom, she will guard you. The beginning of wisdom is this, get wisdom and whatever you get insight. Where do you find that? It's in Scripture. It's in Scripture. Wisdom. Wisdom is contained here. Personal Bible study bathes you in wisdom. Okay, so perk number 8. Going right along here. These next two especially, I see these a lot. I see the struggle. Personal Bible study helps me to verify that the preaching / teaching of others is the truth of God. This is big today. I don't know if you stop to think about this, but because of the explosion of social media, the internet, YouTube, all these things, anybody can title themselves a biblical preacher / teacher and post videos. And it's amazing the number of people that will subscribe to those channels and to those podcasts and listen to these things. And yet, if you listen to a lot of these, and I don't listen to a lot, but I will check in on them every now and then just see what the thing is. You got so many people preaching and teaching as Christian pastors or teachers, and yet the things that they're preaching and teaching are contrary to what the Bible says. And oftentimes, they're coming at it from the angle of, I have a new revelation that God has given to me. And I want to give it to you. And for a $25 love offering, you know how that goes. That is so dangerous. There is no new revelation. There is no new authoritative scriptural revelation from God. He has given us the fullness of his revelation right here. From book 1 to the end of Revelation, it's all right here. And yet there are people that would just buy into that. And you got people preaching and teaching things out here about what's okay and what's not okay. The Apostle Paul dealt with this in the early church, where you had these people would come into the church and claim to have a special knowledge or a hidden knowledge, and so I want to pass it on to you, but I'm going to benefit and profit from it. We need to know whether or not the people we're watching / listening to, whether they're being consistent and true to the Word of God. Because if they're not, you need to quit listening to it. You need to turn it off. You need to find something. There are too many solid biblical teachers out there. You have to be so careful. And if your knowledge of the Word is pretty shallow, okay, yeah, listen, look. A lot of those cats that are out there doing that stuff, they've been practicing. They're smooth. And they can make it sound like absolute. That makes sense. Yeah, I can see how God would say that, or say that's all right. You always have to come back to hear the Word of God. You got to get into it. You got to know the depth of it. You got to hide it in your heart. There's a lot in the Bible about about discerning false teachers, okay? For instance, in 1 Timothy, starting chapter 6, verse 3, if anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, listen to how God describes that kind of person who's teaching untruth here through Timothy's writing. Verse 4, that person is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words, which produce envy and dissension and slander and evil suspicions and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and deprived of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. God is unsparing towards those who distort the authority and the truth of what's already in Scripture. I was pastoring up in North Carolina, and there was a TV preacher, and it used to be 20 years ago, those were the main culprits, the TV preachers. Not all of them. I mean, Charles Stanley was a TV preacher. He was a pretty good preacher. Adrian Rogers was a TV preacher. He was a pretty good preacher. I mean, not all of them. But man, there were some out there that were like, where are you getting this? So up in the North Carolina area where we were serving at that time, there were several people, some even in my church, who seemed to have really developed a liking and a following of a particular, I'm not going to name him, but a particular TV preacher. So I said, I don't see what this guy's all about. So I found out when he was on, what was going on. I was watching one of his sermons one day. And this is a divine kind of thing, because I just caught it. When he was talking about the divine nature of God, and then he started sharing this revelation that God had given him, that God is not three in one, God is nine in one. And I'm like, seminary lied to me. All those learned professors, not a one of them ever said anything about all nine of these facets and faces of the Godhead. And I mean, he went through and basically each one of the three parts of the Trinity that we're all familiar with biblically, God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit, that each one of those three has three distinct personalities and way they're presented. And he broke it down. And, you know, I'm sitting there with my Bible like, it's nowhere in there. And yet, man, the auditorium was full. I mean, it's full. And of course, there was this, what's it called? A Chiron that runs across the bottom line. There's this Chiron running the whole time he's preaching. You know what that Chiron was about? Donations. It wasn't the scripture. It was if you would like to support the ministry of so-and-so. And I'm like, wow. It just amazed me. The number of people that were just absolutely soaking that up. Soaking that up. Like, wow. So we, the body of Christ, in this world we live in, especially now with, I mean, it's so much easier. Just, and you get a YouTube channel. You set up a YouTube channel, and you just get in front of your iPhone and preach your message and put it out there, and whoever wants to watch it can watch it. Man, if you want something entertaining one day, go on YouTube and look up some of those. And you'll sit there and you'll go, seriously? And then look at the people that are listening and that like it. And it's like, what? Yeah. But when you're in the Bible, when you're involved in Bible study, deeper than just Bible reading. We talked about that last week. Bible reading is great. We ought to read it every chance we get or listen to it every chance we get. You know, I've got a lot of times my UVerse app playing over my truck system when I'm riding down the road just hearing the Word of God. That's like, you know, that great splash of water on your face that's refreshing and, you know, wipes away some of the grime of the day. But Bible study is when you get in there and you soak in it. And that Word just gets all in there and cleans and purifies and gives direction and guidance. James 3:13 is another example where Scripture talks about, you know, you got to discern. You got to look at that preacher, that teacher, that leader, and what they're saying and how they're going about it. James 3:13, who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but it's earthly and unspiritual and demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure and then peaceable and gentle and open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Man, we need to clearly know what the Bible teaches about right and wrong so that we can rightly evaluate those who claim to be preachers and teachers of the gospel. And then perk number 9, last one, we'll be done. This is going to sound a little bit like number 8, but it's a little bit different. Personal Bible study trains me to discern cultural deception that is presented as truth, yet it's contrary to Scripture. See, there's a lot of stuff being thrown out here as being truth, and yet it absolutely contradicts God's truth. Okay, so I want to make this really simple. If anything is held up to be a truth, a universal truth that contradicts God's word, it's not a universal truth. It's masquerading as a truth. I use the word cultural because a lot of this is coming out of a lot of the cultural upheaval going on in our world and all these kind of things. You know, Isaiah says, by the way, on your outline there, you see where it says Isaiah 46, 40 verse 6. Everybody see that? Okay, there was a bit of an omission, and it's on me here. That should be Isaiah 40, verses 6 through 8. Okay, so just make a note of that. I'm going to read that passage and then say a couple of words. A voice says, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flower fades. But the word of our God will stand forever. So when we see stuff going on culturally around us in society and stuff being put out there as being truth, you know, and especially since COVID, it's been real popular to say, look at the science, look at the science. As if that's the arbiter of truth, and it's not. Scripture is. Just to give an example. There is this thing going around now that's got to do with human sexuality, whereby there's this really loud minority voice of people that keep shouting that there is such a thing as a non-binary person. That a person can be non-binary, meaning that they're neither male or female. And it's out there. Big. It's big out there. Non-binary. It's almost become kind of a badge of honor to say, I'm non-binary. Sometimes I dress like a girl. Sometimes I dress like a guy. Because I'm neither, you know. All right. And that's being presented. I mean, there are people trying to say there are studies and surveys and all this kind of stuff that back this up. So I bring it to the Word of God. You start in Genesis with this one. So God created us male and female. No other options. There are any out there. There's nothing in Scripture about I create you this way. When you reach the age of accountability, if you want to choose a different gender, that's okay. There's nothing in there about that. And, you know, if you're watching online or if you're in this room wrestling with us, I want you to know God created you. You are a remarkable and wonderful creation. He created you with incredible purpose. He created you on purpose, okay? But your creation is consistent with the Word of God. However you came into this world is how you're going out of this world, male or female. Now, I could sit here and just name 4, 5, or 6 other similar type things But the point is, we've got to be very discerning, and the Word trains us to listen with a discerning ear to the different popular, sometimes faddish things that come up and rise in culture that we want to, that those outside of God's Word want to establish as being true. My friend, I want to encourage you to have the boldness, number one, to study the Word, get into the Word, and have the boldness. When you come across that and you know it's contrary to what God's Word says, I want you to know you will never go wrong standing on the truth of God's Word. You may get persecuted. You may get yelled at. With great grace and compassion, stand on the Word of God in the face of untruth. He will honor that into your life. I promise you. So as we get ready to leave, these are my kind of closing words for today. If you have never really had the habit of regular, deep personal Bible study, I'm asking you over the course of these three Sundays, last Sunday, today, and the next week, to consider starting. It's a discipline. It's something you have to work at to get it established in your life, okay? Consistency is the key to deep Bible study over a lifetime. You know, if I want to get in shape, physically speaking, from a cardio perspective, from a, muscular perspective, whatever, joint perspective, I've got to work out. And I've got to do that on a consistent basis. Working out once a month probably is not going to do a lot. I'm going to undo all the work of that one day a month in those next 4 weeks. That's one of the reasons we're going to have this four-week fast from all food that Dana was talking about earlier, just to kind of get us revved up in that way. No, it's the consistency of applying yourself to getting into and letting the Holy Spirit just bring the truth of Scripture alive in your heart and your soul and your mind, and allowing that to shape you. So as you walk through the world, you're standing on solid ground. All right, we'll look at it more next week. Let's stand up together. We're going to have a prayer, and we're going to go. Again, pray for Jackie Bowen as they have that funeral today at 2 o'clock. Ben will be praying for you on Wednesday. Big day. And all of Mr. Wayne's extended family. Father God, we love you today. We thank you for our time to come together right here on this street corner as the family of Christ that meets here on this piece of land. You've called us to yourself through Jesus Christ, and you have revealed yourself to us in Christ and in your Word. So, Father, would you give us a desire to exercise the self-discipline that we may need to exercise in order to establish in our lives the good habit of regular, consistent Bible study, personal Bible study. Bless each home represented here today and online, and we just love you, and we thank you for Jesus. In his name I pray. Amen.